Thank you. Welcome to First Parish in Needham, a Unitarian Universalist congregation of humanists, theists, atheists, agnostics, and interfaith families. We are a proud LGBTQ welcoming congregation, climate justice seeking green sanctuary, level 2 sanctuary supporting congregation for immigration justice, and 8th principle congregation striving to dismantle racism and other oppressions and build a diverse, multicultural, beloved community. Whoever you are, whether you've been here for years or here on a first visit, whatever your background and wherever you're participating from, you are welcome here. I'm Peter Panov, happily helping on the parish and worship committees. I've been coming since 2016 for spiritual, which I see as related closely to mental well-being. And today, it is my pleasure, on behalf of the worship committee, to introduce Reverend Jamie from Indianapolis as our guest minister today. Our congregation is offering worship and programming with in-person, hybrid, and online gatherings. You can learn more about all that's happening at First Parish by going to our website, uuneedham.org, or by following us on Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube. Our order of service is online too, at the QR code in your pews, and at the website, uuneedham.updates.church. For all Zoom links and the most up-to-date information, please sign up for our weekly email newsletter by going to our website and clicking Get Involved, followed by Newsletter, or setting your request to office@uuneedham.org. Welcome again to everyone here in the building and online, and good morning.
Good morning, everyone. In our incredible excitement to start this morning, we accidentally skipped the prelude, so we're gonna enjoy it now, because when is it not a good time to enjoy a walk with thee? So please enjoy this music before our chalice lighting.
Thank you.
Good morning again. I'm jazzed, ready to go. Thank you for that. Our chalice lighting this morning can be found in your gray hymnals at number 417, For the Beauty of the Earth by Barbara Pescan. For the beauty of the earth, this spinning blue-green ball, yes. Gaia, mother of everything, we walk gently across your back to come together again in this place, to remember how we can live, to remember who we are, to create how we will be. Gaia, our home, the lap in which we live, we light our chalice today in your honor. Our hymn this morning, Morning Has Broken, was written by 20th century British children's writer Eleanor Farrion to fit a traditional Gaelic hymn melody. It was popularized in secular music by modern British Muslim singer-songwriter Yusuf Islam, formerly known as Cat Stevens. This hymn can be found at number 38 in your gray hymnals or in your printed or online order of service. Will you please rise in spirit or body?
In the Unitarian Universalist tradition, the covenant is a set of promises the membership of a congregation strives to honor with one another and out in the world. Whether we participate in our community online or in the building, we strive to live these promises every day. Please say along with me the words of our parish covenant as in your orders of service. We gather as a loving community to encourage and comfort one another. We gather as a diverse community to support each other in our search for spiritual truth. We gather as a service community to live our beliefs through action and care for our world.
Our story this morning is called The Morning After Creation. It was the morning after creation, and all of the animals had assembled together to pick out their niches, their own particular thing that they would do that would be unique to them, so there would not be too much competition with one another. So, for example, Goat said, I will pick eating everything, like everything, and walking straight up mountains, even tin cans, everything. And Tiger Shark said, hey, I like that. I think I will pick eating everything, like everything, even license plates, but I will do it swimming in the sea. Then Flounder, who has two eyes on one side of his face, said, if you're gonna be swimming around up there, I'm gonna pick laying around on the bottom of the ocean and looking like a weird Picasso fish. Eagle said, has anyone taken Soaring Majestically? I think I'll take Soaring Majestically if that's still available. To which Hawk said, huh, I was going to take Soaring Majestically, let's talk. So all of the animals were working out like this together, what their niche was going to be, what their thing was going to be. But then humans said, my niche will be being important. Say that again, said the animals. My thing will be being important, said human, the most important. There was an uncomfortable silence. You can't pick being most important, said Crow. That's not a thing. We're all important. How about your thing is walking on two legs and holding committee meetings? So human agreed to walking on two legs and having committee meetings, but secretly he said to himself, and also being the most important. And the animals said to each other, let's keep an eye on that one. So each animal did its chosen thing, and because they had chosen pretty well, the animals mostly lived in balance and respected each other's boundaries, except for human. Human, because he secretly considered himself the most important, kept expanding into other animals' territory. So, for example, lots of animals fished in the sea, but human fished so much and so aggressively that he began to empty out the oceans for the other animals, and then he filled it with garbage instead. Lots of animals built their homes in the forest, but human began to chop down the forest themselves to build homes for himself everywhere. Lots of animals burrowed down into the Earth Mother for food and shelter, but human began to dig the Earth Mother up in great gouges, looking for oil and minerals and other things useful to human. He even blew the tops off of entire mountains when it suited him. Over time, human's behavior became so outrageous and so disruptive to the other animals that Dog decided that something needed to be done. He decided to domesticate himself to get closer to humans so he could understand. Eventually, Dog went to live in human's house and became a constant companion to human and his family. They became friends of sorts, except that human still believed himself the most important. Dog tried to teach human about other things that were equally important. When they went out on walks, Dog would leap ahead in joy, pointing out the beauty of the fields and the forests. He tried to teach human how to bury his nose deep into the ground to catch the glorious scent of other living beings. Human didn't get it. He tried to teach human the respectful way to greet another being with proper bows and butt sniffs. Human didn't get it. He tried to teach human how to nap and play and not be so important. Sometimes human got it, and then sometimes he seemed to forget. Human could be frustrating. But what did happen over time is that human learned to love Dog. And in this way, he became curious about him. He began to try to understand how the world looked from Dog's point of view, not for his own ends, but because he wanted to be a better friend and companion to him. And in time, human discovered that the other animals were trying to teach him things, not just Dog, but cat, and horse, and cow, and crow, and even whale from far away in the ocean. And human began to wonder for the first time if he was the most important animal after all. It was the beginning. This story doesn't have an ending yet. I wonder if we can think one up together. That is our story for this morning. Thank you for sharing it with me. And now we will sing the children out to their religious exploration classes. Our recessional is Longtime Sun.
Now is the time in our service where we share our joys and concerns that are close to our hearts and lives. If you're here, if you cannot be here in the sanctuary and would like a candle lit, you can pre-submit your candle to me, Dara Bryans, at internminister@uuneedham.org. If you could get it to me on the Thursday before the service, I will be able to include it in this ritual during the service. I'd like to remind you all that our services are live streamed on YouTube, so that we can't guarantee that whatever you share in this sanctuary and in our community will stay within our community. But you are always welcome to reach out to Reverend Katie, to me, or to our Pastoral Associate of the Week, who is Gail Lehman, for pastoral care or to meet privately. So we have one pre-submitted candle this morning, and it's from your staff. And we are offering a candle of sorrow for the impact the freight train derailment in Ohio is having on our environment. May the earth and all its creatures heal swiftly from this injury. And now, if you're here in the sanctuary, I will invite you to come up and offer your candle and speak your joy or concern into the microphone. And if you are visiting online, please add your joy or concern to the chat.
My name is David Mackey. I'm here to light a candle of sorrow for my brother Mac, who died on Tuesday, unexpectedly and shockingly, at age 72. He was out hiking in the morning, had lunch with friends, and then he died very suddenly. And we're all still, honestly, in a state of shock. He's a wonderful guy and a wonderful brother. There's a lovely obituary for my brother in the Globe this morning, but please keep his wife, Cindy, and their three kids and their families in your thoughts and prayers. Thank you.
I'm lighting a candle for everyone in our community who faced hardship in the cold the last few days. Everyone whose heat failed or was woefully inadequate, pipes burst or windows let out too much life-sustaining warmth. I know a few, I'm sure most of us do. Please hold them in your hearts.
My name is Jackie Shepherd, and I guess I was thinking about this morning when I was reading the Times about the millions of dollars more that we're giving to Ukraine, in particular to support democracy. And I have very mixed feelings about it, because I thought about this morning, that all of my grandparents were born in Ukraine. The only grandparent, they left actually because they were Jewish and they were being recruited into the army. The only grandparent I knew, my father spent his early years there. The only grandparent I knew was my grandmother, who I never had a relationship with because she spoke Yiddish. And so I have very mixed feelings, because the millions of dollars were sending there, and yet all of my grandparents. So I just thought of that this morning. Thank you.
For these joys and concerns and all those that remain on our hearts, we will light a final candle.
Won't you join me for a moment of prayer or reflection? Spirit of life, Spirit of love, Spirit of peace, be with us in this place. May love and peace be in our minds and bodies, in our homes and communities. Let us be conscious this morning with gratitude for all the ways in which we are connected, connected to one another and to community, connected to earth, which grounds and nurtures and sustains us, connected to the mystery of life, to the energies of healing and hope and possibility that are ever present in the world, which companion us even in our sorrow, even when they may feel distant and inaccessible. And may we be grateful that we may be the bearers of healing and hope and possibility to each other, that imperfect vessels as we are, just as we are, it may be given to us to be the bringers of love and kindness, of care and compassion, with a word, a gaze, a steadying hand, or with just our presence, our willingness to be there for one another. Spirit, may we be grateful for the gifts we have been given that make us strong and resilient and creative beings. May we know always that we are connected in love and worthy of love. And may the joys and sorrows that are with us today, spoken and unspoken, be held in care and kindness. Our meditative response today is hymn number 15 in your gray hymnal, The Lone Wild Bird.
Hi, everyone. Reverend Jamie, thanks for giving me a break this week. This congregation has been supported by the volunteered time and treasure of its members and friends since its founding in 1711. And this is the time in our service when we, the modern stewards of the church, offer what we can to build and sustain the congregation and the world we envision. This month, our collections are being split 50-50 with the Unitarian Universalist Urban Ministry. The UU Urban Ministry was founded in 1826 by Greater Boston Unitarian congregations to support the Reverend Joseph Tuckerman in his ministry of empowering Boston's most underprivileged residents while transforming the spiritual consciousness of their most privileged neighbors. In 2021, the Urban Ministry adopted a new mission and vision statement, declaring that they work across race and place to dismantle racism and white supremacy culture and to advance racial, social, and economic justice. They envision a greater Boston where all people live with freedom and dignity and have equitable resources and opportunity to shape the present and the future. Their primary programs include safer shelter and work training for domestic violence survivors, academic enrichment for local youth of color, and arts and humanities programming that centers social justice and local artists and historians of color. To donate to today's offering, you can use one of three different methods as described in detail in your orders of service, using our Text to Give program through the number 73256, making a donation at our website, uuneedham.org, or dropping a check or cash into the collection plate, or mailing a check to First Parish at 23 Dedham Avenue. Whichever way you donate, please remember to specify whether your donation is meant for the plate collection or for your annual pledge. And if this is one of your first visits to First Parish, we encourage you to fill out a yellow card in the pew back in front of you and drop it in the offering plate, or fill out our online visitors form at uuneedham.updates.church. Thank you for all that you are able to give to help support and sustain this congregation and the world we envision. And many thanks to Lynn Rockless for our beautiful flowers this morning, given in memory of her beloved parents, Eleanor and Ben Rockless. May the ushers please come forward. Thank you.
Our reading this morning is The Stream of Life by Bengali poet, author, composer, and activist Rabindranath Tagore. In 1913, Tagore became the first non-European to win the Nobel Prize for Literature. The Stream of Life. The stream of life that runs through my veins night and day runs through the world and dances in rhythmic measures. It is the same life that shoots in joy through the dust of the earth in numberless blades of grass and breaks into tumultuous waves of leaves and flowers. It is the same life that is rocked in the ocean cradle, of birth and of death, in ebb and in flow. I feel my limbs are made glorious by the touch of this world of life, and my pride is from the life throb of ages, dancing in my blood this moment. Here ends our reading.
So I want to begin by saying thank you so much for welcoming me to your service this morning, and a special thank you to the musicians for that incredible music this morning. Thank you so much. So next Sunday, February 12th, you may or may not know, is a special day. It is Charles Darwin's birthday, a day that is celebrated in many UU congregations as Evolution Sunday. And it would be Darwin's 214th birthday, to be exact. And even though we're a week early, I wanted to begin today with my favorite Charles Darwin anecdote in his honor. So Charles Darwin, from a very young age, had a hobby of collecting and classifying living things. And he became rather a good amateur naturalist in the process of practicing his hobby. And in particular, as a young student at Christ College at Cambridge, he got taken up with the popular craze of the day for collecting beetles. You don't think as a parent that your kid is going to go off to college and get mixed up in entomology, but it happens. It happens. So one day, Charles was out on the quad, busy not doing his homework, and he happened to spy an unfamiliar species of beetle climbing on a tree. Excited by his discovery, he stopped to gather it in his right hand, where he noticed that there was a regular caravan of beetles going up and down the trunk of the tree, so he grabbed another specimen in his left hand. And then, having run out of useful appendages, but with more beetles still within easy reach, he did what any coleopterologist, any beetle guy worth his salt would do. He put the beetles in his mouth for safekeeping, so he could gather some more. Whereupon the beetles, much aggrieved and aggressed upon, sprayed a noxious blast of chemicals from their hind ends directly onto his tongue. So from Charles Darwin, we learn two important things. All life on Earth arose and is interconnected through a continuously unfolding natural process that took place over billions of years. And very importantly, when securing beetles with your mouth for safekeeping, place them between the lips, butt side facing out. Right? If you remember one thing from this sermon. So you might not think so from this anecdote, but Charles Darwin was one of the greatest geniuses who ever lived. One of the greatest scientists who ever lived. The influence of Darwin's work on later scientific study is really incalculable. He's the foundation from which all life, scientists, and natural historians begin. Outside the sciences, his ideas shook the pillars of Western civilization, challenged old worn-out notions of philosophy and religion. He revolutionized our understanding of what it means to be human and what our place in the web of life is, and 214 years later, we are still wrestling with and working out the implications of his discoveries. And yet Darwin is a different kind of genius than what we usually think of. He's not the picture we usually have of this sort of unparalleled intellect having a eureka moment and all these great ideas like spill out of their overheated brain. He's not an Einstein imagining himself riding on a beam of light and then having a flash of insight that would become the theory of special relativity. He's not the young Sir Isaac Newton who, cooped up at home for a couple of summers, college being closed for the plague, invented calculus, optics, and the law of gravity just to kill some time. True story. Isaac Newton redefined what it means to say, yeah, I had a pretty good year. Darwin's genius was of a different sort. Darwin's genius was grounded in a passionate love of seeing, of carefully examining the natural world around him, of awe and delight, of taking it all in, sketching it out in his notebooks. And then his genius was in the enormous patience with which he made his scientific case, with which he formulated his ideas after he had begun to suspect what he had begun to suspect. He painstakingly accumulated data and corroborating evidence from many different scientific branches: zoology, geology, botany, paleontology, animal husbandry, from the study of many diverse kinds of life: beetles, turtles, the famous Galapagos finches, carrier pigeons, bivalves, orchids, primates. He built the case for his great idea from a mountain of evidence over decades, only finally taking his ideas to the public when it seemed like he was about to be scooped by someone else. And by then, his work was unassailable. So Charles Darwin, of course, is the person credited with the discovery of evolution through natural selection. And the word evolution can be a little ambiguous because it is commonly used to refer to two different things. Evolution can refer to the facts of the history of life on Earth, that all present-day living things, you, me, algae, antelopes, water bears, orchids, zucchinis, badgers, mushrooms, all can be traced back through time to a single common ancestor, which was basically a leaky bag of cell bits powered by light. Or evolution can refer to the process by which all of this magnificent living variation sprang out of a single simple ancestral organism. The most important component of the process, the one Darwin identified, is natural selection. Right? Small changes by random mutations accumulating over time as they prove beneficial. Multiply those selected changes by billions of years, and you go from single-celled organisms like bacterium to multi-celled organisms like Ryan Gosling. And it was Darwin's genius to identify both the fact of evolution and the process of evolution, and again, to painstakingly accumulate this massive body of evidence. Today, evolution in both meanings of the word is as much established fact as anything in science can be. And yet the radical implications of his discovery and the spiritual implications of his discovery, we are still wrestling with, because evolution calls us to rethink and reimagine our relationship to life on Earth. Before the theory of evolution, the fundamental story to explain the appearance of and diversity of life on Earth, at least in the West, which is where we are, was the book of Genesis in the Hebrew Bible, also known as the Christian Old Testament, right? The book of Genesis says, of course, that the universe, the Earth, all life was created over the course of 6 days by God, and then to cap off this project, at the end of the sixth day, God created humans as a special act of creation, as the only object of creation made in the image of God. And then God put us in charge of everything that came before. In the story, we humans are granted dominion over the earth and all its living things. And evolution takes the idea of the special creation of human life, a life that's radically different from all other kinds of living beings, and it replaces it with the idea that all life, including our own, is the product of one continuous unfolding process, right? Set in motion ultimately by the birth of the universe. Evolution replaces the 6 days of Genesis with 14 billion years, give or take. 12 billion years from the Big Bang to make a Milky Way galaxy and to shape and cool and properly water a nutrient-rich planet Earth. An unknown amount of time for some of those nutrients to spontaneously organize into replicating molecule chains. And then 2 billion years, give or take, for those replicating molecule chains to organize into living cells. And then for those living cells to diversify into all of the life we see around us. And Charles Darwin surmised, and science tends to confirm his view, that all living things alive today are the common descendants ultimately of one ancestral organism. And from this single root grew the tangled tree of life as species branched off and branched off and branched off, each finding their own unique way to make a successful living in the ecosystem. But here's the thing. Popular depictions of evolution often greatly simplify this process to show a linear march of life forms through time, right? We've seen the posters with the fish like crawling out of the water, evolving into the reptile, the mammal, primates, humans. The arrangement suggests a process of replacement of one thing turning into another, newer, better thing. It reads like a story of progress, where humans are again at the end of progress. And in this way, the emotional content of the old dominion idea of humanity's specialness is preserved still within the new framework of evolution. We think naturally in terms of lower and higher life forms, and we place ourselves at the top of that ladder of being. And so the question is sometimes asked as a challenged evolution, thinking of life as this progression from worse to better, that if monkeys evolved into humans, why are monkeys still around? Which is a misunderstanding of evolution, but the question is, if the lower forms evolved into higher life forms, why weren't the lower forms replaced? But this is a misunderstanding, right? Monkeys did not evolve into humans. Rather, monkeys and humans share a common ancestor, which means at one point in time, there was a species that was not a monkey and not a human, and some of its ancestors settled on the monkey way of being in the world, which is awesome. And some of its ancestors settled on the human way of being in the world, which is also awesome. So evolution is not a linear progression. It is a branch giving rise to more branches, branches, and branches. And our human species then is like one tiny green shoot on one of millions of branches of the tree of life, each having come into existence in exactly the same way, each sharing the common trait of having found an awesome way of being in the world. How absurd then to circle our tiny green shoot on this enormous bristling plant of healthy, successful growths and say, well, this is clearly the reason the plant exists. And all of the whole must exist to serve this little tiny shoot. Evolution has been called a second Copernican revolution. The first Copernican revolution said the Earth, and thus humankind, is not at the center of the universe, but lies in one corner of a spiraling galaxy amid billions of galaxies. Evolution, the second Copernican revolution, says humankind is not at the center of the biosphere either. We're not a special act of creation made by God on the sixth day. We are not above other living things. And in this way, evolution proposes a radical decentering of the human story and the overall story of life on Earth. Because we are one species among millions, all created by the same unthinking process, neither more nor less likely, neither more nor less chosen, neither more nor less destined to a bright future. Evolution tells us, in the words of UU minister Forrest Church, that we come from a common source and we share a common destiny. And what a common source it is. Right? Born of ancient stars whose matters traversed billions of miles of space to shape our galaxy, our world, and ultimately become our very flesh and blood. We have stardust in our bones and stardust in our veins, and our story is as old as the universe and inseparable from the universe. What mystery and magic and dignity there is in this story of life. Now, you can certainly believe in evolution and still believe in some concept of God or deity. 30% of Americans who believe in evolution also believe the process was set in motion or somehow inspired or guided by a divine being. Scientifically speaking, the theory of evolution does not require a helper God, but it's not incompatible with a helper God. What I would say is, if you believe that evolution is the means by which God created life, then I would urge you to consider the story of evolution as an alternative creation text. Why did God choose this process over all the others? A process which emphasizes not our separateness, but our kinship, our interconnectedness, our interdependence with all other living things. And then what message do we read in the scientific text about the intentions of our Creator, if Creator we have? The dominion mythos, I believe, has been a ticking time bomb within our culture. So long as humans were limited in their capacity to materially affect their environment, Right, this dominion worldview might condone the local exploitation of animals, the local despoliation of the environment, but it couldn't break out to do global harm. But for the last several centuries, our astonishing increase in technological prowess has been harnessed to the engines of global capitalism to exert our dominion over the natural world to an unprecedented degree. And too late, we are discovering, as climate change and species extinction spiral out of control, that our pretense at dominion is an illusion. That we remain in the end utterly dependent on natural systems vastly greater than our ability to predict and control. And so we need a creation story that emphasizes our kinship with the web of life. We need a creation story that restores the dignity of the natural world and all its living inhabitants. We need a creation story that brings us back into oneness with the processes that nurture and sustain us. And we need a creation story that reconnects us to the enchantment and the awesomeness of the natural world. And these creation stories exist in other cultures. Biologist Robin Wall Kimmerer, who's also a member of the Potawatomi Nation, writes in her book, Braiding Sweetgrass, "In the Western tradition, there's a recognized hierarchy of beings, with, of course, the human on top, the pinnacle of evolution, the darling of creation. But in native ways of knowing, human people are often referred to as the younger siblings of creation. We say that humans have the least experience with how to live, and thus the most to learn. And she says we must look to our teachers among the other species for guidance. Their wisdom is apparent in the way that they live. They have been on the earth far longer than we have," she concludes, "and they've had time to figure things out." And so in a 2015 article called Nature Needs a New Pronoun, Robin Wall Kimmerer relates how Darwin's fundamental scientific discovery that all life is not just interrelated, but literally related, that all living things are kin, this insight is already embedded into the very language of some native people. So Kimmerer says that in her native language of Anishinaabe, which was erased from her family in the boarding schools and which she is relearning, it is impossible to speak of a living being as an it. In Anishinaabe and many other indigenous languages, she says, we use the same words to address all living beings as we do our family, because they are our family. And imagine if embedded in our language itself was the idea that nature was our kin. How different would our world be? Would our oceans be dying? Would our forests be disappearing? Would the mass extinction of non-human species be an unrecognized, uncontested, unchallenged reality as it in fact is today? How differently would we orient ourselves to the world if we saw it as kin, which it is? Darwin wrote, "There is grandeur in this view of life, with its several powers having been originally breathed into a few forms or into one. From so simple a beginning, endless forms, most beautiful and most wonderful, have been and are being evolved." End quote. There is grandeur in this view of life. It is the view of life to which our seventh Unitarian Universalist principle calls us, one rooted in the most profound respect for the great web of being, in profound gratitude to life and our relationship to it, and one which must call us to some grief for the ways in which we have dishonored that relationship, in which we have torn the fabric of the web. Written into each creature, howsoever humble, is the history of the universe. You, me, the squirrels chasing each other on the lawn, the insects churning the soil underneath, the birds serenading us from above, we are all part of the same ancient story of life unfolding since even before the stars lit the skies. And within us and through us all moves the same creative force, bringing endless new forms of life into being. The same stream of life that runs through my veins night and day, says the poet Tagore, runs through the world and dances in rhythmic measures. May we encounter this enchanted world and know its ancient beauty, feel our deep kinship with life teeming all around, And so let us learn a new creation story, not a story of separation and domination, but a story of connection and care, a story of kinship. And may this new story be a story of renewal, a story of hope, and a story of healing for our world that so needs healing. Blessed be, and amen.
I can't believe how lucky we are to have the music that we have here at this church. So as we approach the close of our service, we have, as usual, a good number of announcements. So please, as always, join us for a time of fellowship after the service. We gather in Parish Hall. If you are joining us online, please use the Zoom room link in the bell notes to join us for fellowship after the service. The COVID task force is asking for feedback. Please fill out their survey that's in the bell notes. The caregivers support group meets today at 12:30 on Zoom. Reverend Katie is leading a discussion group this afternoon on The Silencing White Noise by Rev. Willie Duane Francois III. As some of you may remember, there was a Lane Lyceum that he led, and you can watch that on our YouTube channel and join us for the discussion at 3:00.
This Tuesday will be the Lane Lyceum talking technicalities in the realm of criminal justice with Professor Daniel Medwed. He will be discussing his new book, Barred, Why the Innocent Can't Get Out of Prison. On Friday, we have a new program led by Sarah Elizabeth. It's a monthly family game and movie night that everyone is welcome to. And this Friday, the 10th, they will be playing Lasers and Feelings, a cooperative game featuring an adventure set on a spaceship. Details can be found in the bell notes. And then finally, a quick reminder that our regular weekly events are happening. There's the Writing Escapes on Thursday morning, Vespers in the afternoon, Meditation Ministries, and on Friday mornings we have Creative Escapes. A lot going on, so please watch out for church communications, the bell notes, and other things coming from the church to keep you up to date on what's happening here. So as we do each week, we extinguish our chalice with the words from Unitarian Universalist minister, the Reverend Elizabeth Sellie Jones. Please join me in saying these words. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, nor the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again. Our closing hymn is number 203, All Creatures of the Earth and Sky. The lyrics are from a canticle prayer of by the 13th century lay friar, St. Francis of Assisi. Our hymnal's text is directly translated from the Italian, and you can find these lyrics at number 203 in the gray hymnal or in your printed or online orders of service. Please rise in spirit or in body and join in singing.
Thank you.
Robin Wall Kimmerer says, "Know the ways of the ones who take care of you so that you may take care of them. Introduce yourself. Be accountable as the one who comes asking for life. Ask permission before taking and abide by the answer. Sustain the ones who sustain you, and the earth will last forever." May our relationship with life around us be rooted in respect, curiosity, and mutuality, receiving the earth's gifts with gratitude and honoring her in return with care. Go in peace and amen.